civilized and cultured people surrendered its will to a charismatic political leader. The story began 100 years ago, here in the Austrian town of Braunau, with a child born in this house, Adolf Hitler.
Für Sie genügt nicht die bloße Ablegung des Bekenntnisses, ich glaube, sondern der Schwur, ich kämpfe!
When I came face to face with Hitler, I felt I had come face to face with God.
He wanted to create a better world. And when he died, I had the feeling I had lost my father.
In the death camps of the Second World War, Hitler's Germany came closer than human beings have ever come to creating hell on earth. The terrible truth, which most people still find too terrible to accept, is that despite his crimes against humanity, Hitler was a political genius, a man with a fatal attraction for the German people. At his peak, the most popular ruler in Europe. The child born here in Braunau belonged to that handful of human beings who have clearly and decisively changed the history of the 20th century. Linz, Austria, the site of the only memorial to the Hitler family, the grave of Hitler's parents. Nothing about his parents or Adolf's early life gave any hint of the extraordinary career that was to come. His father, Alois, was a stern, short-tempered customs official who beat his son. His mother, Clara, tried to protect him. When she died, young Adolf was broken by grief. He kept her portrait with him for the rest of his life. The infant Adolf was baptized and brought up as a Catholic. At the age of 6, he entered the monastery school at Lambach. Soon, he was top of his class. Hitler was a chorister at the great Abbey Church of Lambach. "I used," he said, "to intoxicate myself with the solemn splendor of the services." Every day when he sang in the choir, he saw the memorial to an earlier abbot. Above it was an emblem which a quarter of a century later, Hitler was to adopt for the Nazi party, the swastika. In his teens, Hitler became a moody adolescent. At secondary school in Linz, he lost interest in most of his work. His ambition was to go to Vienna and become an artist or architect. Once there, he produced architectural drawings and watercolors like these, competent, but not good enough to win the place he longed for at the Viennese Academy of Fine Arts. Little by little, all Hitler's early ambitions in Vienna turned sour. After the shock of being turned down twice by the Academy of Fine Arts, he became a drifter. Hitler later called his period in Vienna the most miserable time of my life. 3 of those miserable years were spent here in a Viennese backstreet at this hostel for homeless men. In this depressing hostel, the future Führer passed much of the day sitting with other inmates, churning out drawings and watercolors which earned him a modest income. When he drifted from Vienna to Germany in 1913, he was still dreaming of becoming a great artist or famous architect. Munich, the 1st of August, 1914. A cheering crowd welcomes the outbreak of the First World War. On the right is a photographer, and among the crowd he's photographing is the 25-year-old Adolf Hitler. Now, for the first time, film has been discovered of Hitler at this turning point in his life, as he waits to enlist as a soldier. For me, as for every German, said Hitler, there now began the greatest, most unforgettable time in my earthly existence. He discovered in war a sense of purpose he had failed to find in peace. The years of drifting were at an end. When his unit arrived here in the fields of Flanders, he had no doubt that Germany would win a great victory and that his destiny was to take part in it. Then came the misery of trench warfare. Here in this group of dugouts and trenches near the town of Ypres, Hitler spent days on end, knee-deep in the mud, while enemy artillery pounded the German line. Hitler served as battalion messenger, which was anything but a soft option. Part of the two-mile run to battalion HQ ran the gauntlet of enemy machine guns. From one of these covered trenches, Hitler wrote to a friend, "I've been risking my life every day, looking death straight in the eye." His commanders tended to agree. Hitler's bravery won him the Iron Cross twice. On one occasion, he captured four French soldiers single-handed. The day he received his first Iron Cross was, he said, "the happiest day of my life." Fighting opposite Hitler during the last German offensive in 1918 was the future British Prime Minister Anthony Eden. Later, in the 1930s, the two men reminisced together.
"I remarked to Hitler that this was nearly the anniversary of the 21st of March, 1918, when the Germans broke through the Fifth Army and very nearly got to the Channel ports. And he said, 'Were you in that battle?' So I said, 'Yes.' And he said, 'So was I.' And became very eager and talked all about it. And we discovered that we were virtually opposite each other. And on the back of the menu card, we drew our lines. He drew his side of the line, I drew mine, with his signature at the bottom on the other side. And let me tell you, the corporal knew a great deal about that line and where everybody was, much more than I think an average corporal could be expected to know."
Until almost the last moment of the war, Hitler kept his faith in a glorious German victory. But in the autumn of 1918, his world collapsed around him. A gas attack left him blind for several weeks. Then came the even greater shock of the German surrender. Defeat was followed by a humiliating peace at Versailles. The injustice of Versailles rankled with most Germans for the next 20 years. Unable to accept that the German army had lost the war, Hitler convinced himself that the soldiers had been stabbed in the back by communist revolutionaries and parliamentary politicians. This is a contemporary poster. The stab in the back, he believed, was part of a great Jewish conspiracy. The Jews, the oldest scapegoats in European history, became in Hitler's embittered imagination the scapegoats for Germany's humiliation. "The filthy Jewish rabble," he declared, "drove our people into the dreadful calamity of 1918. Hitler's obsession with that calamity propelled him into politics.
"Well, I think there are many situations in human history where people are in trouble and despair following a defeat, following upheaval, and somehow or other it lacks somebody to pull it together. And that was the case in 1918 in Germany. But I think that Hitler, one could perfectly well see, might well have gone to his death as just a crank who nobody took seriously, who was a bore in a bar. But the situation was there, and for once the situation didn't produce but found a man who could take command of it."
Suddenly, Hitler discovered the greatest talent he possessed, the gift of public speaking. That extraordinary gift later became the key to his fatal attraction for the German people. Already, Hitler was obsessed by the racist vision of a new Germany, freed from the Jewish yoke, rescued from defeat, dominating Europe. He joined a small group of fanatical nationalists in Munich. They became the National Socialist German Workers' Party, or Nazis. In 1921, Hitler became their leader. The first film of the apprentice Führer campaigning shows him as still a rather awkward figure, not yet certain of his role as Germany's messiah. In 1923, Hitler felt strong enough to try and seize power in Munich. Emil Klein, the only stormtrooper still alive who marched with Hitler, now retraces their steps. Everything went well until the marchers found armed police blocking their exit from a narrow street.
We were still singing as we marched down the street. And suddenly, we heard shots being fired ahead of us.
Der Zug hielt. Wir waren sprachlos.
The procession stopped.
Fanden keine Erklärung.
We were speechless and couldn't explain what had happened until word came from the front of the march saying that Hitler was dead.
Ich sah Männer.
I saw men with tears in their eyes. And I myself was very moved too, and had great difficulty keeping myself under control.
Though Hitler in fact survived the hail of bullets, he was arrested and locked in a cell at Landsberg prison. At first he was so depressed he refused to eat. Then his confidence returned as he discovered that the failed uprising had made him a local hero. At the trial, Hitler rounded on his accusers. He told the judges who gave him a prison sentence, history will tear to tatters the verdict of this court. After the propaganda triumph at his trial, Hitler set out to write the Bible of National Socialism. He dictated much of the text here in his cell to his faithful follower, Rudolf Hess. On Saturday evenings, the other prisoners sat around as Hitler read out the completed chapters to them. The book as a whole dwells on the great obsessions which had come to dominate Hitler's political thought. The Jews, racism, living space for the German people, the evils of communism and parliamentary democracy. But it also includes Hitler's views on a variety of other topics, ranging from boxing to syphilis. Though Hitler was a great speaker, he was an indifferent writer. The amazing appeal Hitler was later to exercise was based not on the turgid prose of Mein Kampf, but on his mastery of the spoken word. After prison, the leader, or Führer as he now called himself, had a new political strategy. Instead of planning another coup, he aimed to win power at the polls. Hitler's obsession with the Jews and living space in Eastern Europe could never have given him mass support. What was to win him millions of votes was instead his vision of a great national revival. Hitler's election opportunity came with the onset of the Depression. In a few years, one in three of the labor force was out of work. The Nazis claimed to have the answer. Ilse Wendel was a church social worker during the Depression among the unemployed in the Berlin slums. By 1932, German industrial production had fallen by almost half. Among the unemployed in these slums, she found a pervading sense of hopelessness about the future.
It's the poverty which still strikes you here, very much indeed. You can see how destructive the walls are. You can see it there. The houses were so near to each other that the women talked to each other from the windows. What I do miss are children. When I came here, there were many children playing around, dozens of them. The despair was so terrible as I can't describe it. You had everywhere beggars, wherever you went in Berlin, you had beggars. The people came onto the courtyards and were singing and singing just for a penny.
The democratic political parties offered no solution. To millions of Germans, the only hope was Adolf Hitler.
I supported Hitler because he, after having seen all that depravity, all that poverty here, was the only one who could do social justice to the people here. They were in a terrible misery.
Using the slogan, "The Führer over Germany," Hitler became the first politician to use the aeroplane to campaign in several different cities on the same day. His message was simple. Only he could save Germany. By 1932, at the depth of the Depression, the Nazis, with over a third of the vote, were easily the largest political party, and easily their greatest asset was Hitler's oratory.
He had that ability which is needed to make people stop thinking critically and just emote. The ability derived from his readiness to throw himself totally open, to appear, as it were, bare and naked before his audience, to tear open his heart and display it.
Before the audience hear his messianic vision of a great national revival, Hitler builds up the suspense by keeping them waiting, often for an hour or more. At the speaker's platform, Hitler adds to the tension by keeping his audience waiting again. He does what no politician nowadays would dare to do. For a full minute, he stays silent. When he feels he's gauged the mood of the audience, he starts, but slowly and quietly.
He had an actor's ability to throw on a few extra generators and suddenly become absolutely charged with energy.
Vor dieses Volk hinzutreten und billige Versprechungen zu geben. Es kann niemand hier gegen mich aufstehen und zeigen, was ich je gesagt habe. Der Wiederaufstieg Deutschlands sei nur eine Frage von wenigen Tagen. Immer und immer wieder predige ich, der Wiederaufstieg der deutschen Nation ist die Frage der Wiedergewinnung der inneren Kraft und Gesundheit des deutschen Volkes.
It wasn't as though he was using words, it's as though the emotions came direct without words almost. There was a rawness about it, a power.
In uns selbst allein liegt die Zukunft des deutschen Volkes. Wenn wir selbst dieses deutsche Volk emporführen durch eigene Arbeit, durch eigenen Fleiß, eigene Entschlossenheit, eigenen Trotz, eigene Beharrlichkeit, dann werden wir wieder emporsteigen, genau wie die Väter einst auch Deutschland nicht geschenkt erhielten, sondern selbst ihn schaffen mussten.
Nobody, has ever had this power to move audiences. Gee. And this is not just the man in the street, this is many German intellectuals who are moved by this appeal and stirred by this extraordinary self-confidence in this man. And what he says is the way he says it. You come back to that. And that's a very disconcerting thing for people. So they want somehow or another to explain it away. But it's there.
In January 1933, Hitler comes to power, not as he had hoped through outright victory at the polls, but as head of a coalition government. As this withering glance suggests, Hitler despises his coalition partners. He quickly outmaneuvers them and establishes his own dictatorship.
A month after he comes to power, the Reichstag building, the parliament building in Berlin, is set on fire. This happens to come at the time when he is constantly insisting that there is a communist plot to overthrow the new government and to carry out a revolution. And the Reichstag fire goes up in flames, which everybody could see. Before that night was over, he had got a set of decrees drawn up which transformed the situation politically. All the guarantees in which people in any democratic state, the freedom of speech and so on, freedom from arrest, all this is swept away.
In Berlin, wie in anderen Universitätsstädten Deutschlands, wurden undeutsche und unsittliche Bücher von den Studenten eingesammelt und öffentlich verbrannt.
A majority of Germans tolerate the burning of books, the banning of other political parties, and the setting up of a police state, because Hitler offers a way out of the depression.
If he's doing things which are not so good, which haven't, then we said, well, you have to take the rough with the smooth. Dictatorship seemed to be, not that I wanted it, but it seemed to be the only way to get out of the mess. So I thought that was a good thing that they cut away all this nonsense and rather did something, really did something, and that's what Hitler did. He really went to town with Germany.
Of course, he had the mise-en-scène, the enormous masses of troops, the flags, the music, the grandeur of it all, which made Cecil B. DeMille look rather paltry. Hitler had a serious message which concerned every German anyhow, the humiliation of Versailles, the economic difficulties, but above all, the injury to their national pride. And he eliminated, at the cost of planning a war, he eliminated the crushing unemployment that Germany suffered. And he gave millions of people new confidence and indeed welfare. They were doing better, much better.
Feverish Nazi propaganda depicted Germany's economic recovery as simply a matter of the Führer pressing the right buttons. He spends his way out of the depression by public works and secret rearmament. The image left by the newsreels is of Hitler, with varying degrees of aplomb, opening one new motorway after another. Some of the recovery was due to the policies of previous governments, but Hitler took the credit for it all. From the beginning to the end of Hitler's Germany, Those who were most vulnerable to his appeal were the young. They came in their tens of thousands, full of youthful idealism to worship the Führer in the awesome surroundings of the Nuremberg Stadium. Among the worshippers in the Hitler Youth was Alfons Heck, now a writer on the Nazi period.
The decisive turning point in my life occurred at the age of 10. From that moment on, I would remain beholden to Adolf Hitler long until after our defeat. I was one of 82,000 members of the Hitler Youth lined up in the Zeppelin's field. I stood in the first row. And when Hitler began to speak, we were just tingling with nervousness, finally to see our God. When he appeared on the podium, I was afraid to look at my neighbor because I didn't want him to see the tears in my eyes. My knees were shaking. And Hitler beamed down on us. He calmed us down by lifting his hands, both hands, several times. When he began to speak, it was in a very conversational tone. Man to boy, father to son.
Und ich weiß, das kann nicht anders sein. Denn ihr seid Fleisch von unserem Fleisch und Blut, von unserem Blut. Und in euren jungen Gehirn brennt derselbe Geist, der uns beherrscht.
And he said how fortunate we were to live in this new age. And he said, from now on, you no longer have to fear any class distinction. You're all one, belonging to me. But the essence and the emphasis occurred in the final sentences. He leaned over the podium, and I know he looked straight into my eyes, and he said, you, my boys, the young of Germany, live in a fortunate time because you are the standard bearers of the movement. You will inherit what we have so far created. One day you are going to rule the world. And from that moment on, without any doubt, I was bound to Adolf Hitler long until after our defeat.
Vor uns liegt Deutschland, in uns marschiert Deutschland und hinter uns kommt Deutschland.
At the heart of the fatal attraction was a fatal deception. Hitler promised his adult followers that the new Germany would, in his words, secure peace in the world. All the time, he planned a war in Eastern Europe to conquer a great empire for the master race. Most Germans were opposed to war. But when war came, it was too late to break the spell cast by Hitler's messianic leadership. The mid-1930s were the halcyon years of Hitler's Germany. Germany was at peace, her prosperity restored, her national pride recovered. To those prepared to ignore or justify the police state, it seemed a beautiful Germany. A host of distinguished foreign visitors, many with impeccable democratic credentials, came to call on the Führer at his mountain retreat, the Berghof. Among them was the former British Prime Minister, David Lloyd George. With LG was his secretary, Albert Sylvester.
Hitler ran down the flight of stairs to welcome LG as he got out of his car, shook hands with him most warmly, and conducted us into the inside of the Berghof. I asked Ribbentrop whether Hitler would permit me to take photographs, and he asked the Führer, and Hitler nodded to me that I could.
Mr. Sylvester's home movie, taken inside the Berghof, shows Britain's leader in the First World War being given a guided tour by Germany's Führer in the Second.
He took us round and round this massive room, the only light of which came from a massive window, which was terrific. I've never seen such a window. Then we were taken by him to tea. Tea was already laid on low tables, round which we all sat. There were 13 of us, and we were served by special officers, obviously belonging to Hitler's guard. The highlight of the tea party was when Hitler suddenly produced a photograph of himself, which he had signed, and he presented it to Lloyd George. It was in a beautiful frame. Lloyd George was very touched indeed. He rose from his seat, he grasped Hitler by the hand and thanked him profusely. Lloyd George said, "You have done great things for Germany. You have restored her honor, and you have gained for her equal rights in the world."
These overgrown ruins are all that now remain of the Berghof. It was here, far from the millions of his followers, that Hitler felt most able to relax. The inner circle at the Berghof saw a quite different man from the charismatic Führer of the party rallies. For Hitler's cronies, like Foreign Minister von Ribbentrop, seen here in the Berghof home movies, life at Hitler's retreat was both reassuring and agreeable. And there was an entertaining side to the off-duty Führer, as Ribbentrop's private secretary discovered.
I was overwhelmed by the possibility to meet the Führer personally. And for instance, for the beginning, he was a sort of a messiah for me. He was a man who liked a joke. He could laugh a lot. He didn't accept two sort of jokes, dirty jokes and political jokes. They were banned. But all the other jokes he enjoyed terribly. I even remember that one day he stepped on a stool and imitated an opera actress. And I thought, that's not true. And I thought, now a photo or a wire, that would be $1 million or something.
Hitler had no close friends in whom to confide his innermost feelings. He could never admit human weakness to anyone. But the inner circle discovered one secret of his private life, which was unknown to ordinary Germans.
When Hitler was talking with Ribbentrop for hours, and I was standing near to the wall, waiting until they want some papers or something, and the curtain opened and a rather common face of Eva Braun appeared and said, "Adolf, we must have luncheon now, please stop." No, and I thought such interruption was awful. No.
Eva was a loyal and demanding girl with a love of sport and fashion. She adored Hitler. She spent most of her time without him, pining for an attention which he rarely gave her.
Drei rote Rosen gab sie mir mit ihrer zarten Hand. Sie zupften mir, sie welken mir, und wenn sie welken...
Nobody knew at that moment about the existence of her. And I think Hitler had her because she was simple and she didn't bother him with political questions, and he didn't want to give her influence, and he thought that as long as he is a bachelor, he has the love from the German women, because if he's married, the impression is not the same on the other women. And she gave him a little bit a home of a bourgeois quality, with tea, with cake, and I think with sex, but no more.
You think it was a sexual relationship?
Certainly, certainly.
A less respectful member of the inner circle took a rather idiosyncratic view of Hitler's sex life.
He only loved his mother. She was the fountain of admiration, motherly admiration, you know. She, one mother can supplant a whole audience in Albert Hall. You must realize that. But he had her picture facing his bed. That was the Rock of Gibraltar for him.
Putzi Hamstengel was Hitler's foreign press officer. He had known him well since the early days of the Nazi Party.
He was, to my mind, an important admirer of the super goddess of Venus. He was a soloist, he was autochtone. He probably, I had the impression that he never had really been with a woman partner in the last degree of contact. It was all sort of a plastic thing for him, the sight of a woman's body. That was enough for him.
Since coming to power, Hitler had posed publicly as a man of peace. Privately, he told his generals to prepare for war. His aim was first to unite all the German-speaking peoples in a greater Germany, then to embark on a war of conquest in Eastern Europe. After 5 years in power, he began to shed the mantle of the peacemaker.
I think that in some period around the end of 37-38, Hitler feels, well, this is fine, but I didn't come to power just to restore German self-confidence and so on. There's more. He changes gear, I think. And then he sweeps, you know, there is getting rid of a number of the old guard in the army and the foreign office and so on. And he becomes more aggressive, more provocative.
Hitler's first step towards a greater Germany was union with Austria, the country of his birth. In March 1938, German troops crossed the Austrian border to be welcomed by ecstatic crowds. The other European powers did nothing. After Austria, Hitler's next target was Czechoslovakia. Reinhard Spitze, secretary of Ribbentrop, the German foreign minister, revisits the building where the Munich conference was held in September 1938. Hitler planned to invade Czechoslovakia, ostensibly to free the German minority there. The conference tried to find a peaceful solution. The delegates agreed in this room on a settlement which forced the Czechs to surrender the German-speaking area. Nowadays, Munich is remembered as a German victory and a humiliating act of appeasement by Britain and France. At the time, Hitler felt he had been deprived of a war of conquest.
Hitler didn't like this Munich conference because he had the feeling that he was cheated of his little war, smashing Czechoslovakia, and Hitler was very much annoyed by this sort of democratic conversation.
The British Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, flew home to a hero's welcome in London, waving a piece of paper signed by Hitler. It meant, he said, not only peace with honor, but peace for our time. Back in Munich, Reinhard Spitze heard what Hitler thought of that piece of paper.
When Hitler and Ribbentrop stepped out from this building, I was following them, and I listened to their conversation. Ribbentrop complained about the ridiculous piece of paper that Hitler had signed together with Chamberlain.
Hitler said, "Don't bother. This piece of paper has no importance at all." And then I heard and I was convinced that Hitler did not intend to keep the Munich Agreement.
Though Hitler disliked the Munich Agreement, it made him more popular than ever. A wave of relief and gratitude for the Führer swept Germany. His iron nerve, it was believed, had freed the Germans in Czechoslovakia and yet averted war.
If Hitler had died in 1938, let's say, before the war started, before there was any genocide, I am sure he would have gone down in German history as one of the greatest, perhaps the greatest German statesman who ever lived, despite the obvious harassment of the Jews.
November 1938, the Nazis organize a great anti-Jewish pogrom, the Night of the Broken Glass. All over Germany, synagogues are burnt, Jewish shop windows are broken. Thousands of Jews are arrested, thousands more emigrate. Bemused Germans see stormtroopers attack the houses of their Jewish neighbors.
Well, when the stormtroopers came, they entered the house screaming aloud, "Juda, verrecke! Raus mit den Juden," and they entered the flat of the Goldbergs and threw their piano out of the window. They threw a typewriter out of the window and they smashed the furniture inside their flat. I didn't understand the world anymore. I asked my mother, "Why are these men doing such things?" And she told me, "Don't worry, they are Jews anyway." And I said, "Well, are there other kind of people?" And she said, "Yes, they are like vermin in the larder."
Sie sind hinterlistig, feige und grausam und treten meist in großen Scharen auf.
In this Nazi propaganda film, Jews are portrayed as plague-carrying rats. Though many Germans were prejudiced against the Jews, only a very small minority shared Hitler's homicidal antisemitism. But Hitler's control of the media and education gradually persuaded most Germans to ignore what was happening to the Jews.
The teachers told us, "Don't worry about what you see, even if you see some nasty things which you may not understand. Always think Hitler wants to create a better Germany, a clean Germany, and don't worry, everything will work out fine in the end."
Many Germans, up until the Kristallnacht, believed Hitler was engaged not in genocide, certainly. It seemed to be a minor form of harassment of a disliked minority. But after the Night of the Broken Glass or the Kristallnacht, no German could any longer be under any illusion. I believe it was the day that we lost our innocence. But it would be fair to point out that I, myself, never met even the most fanatic leader of the Hitler Youth who advocated the extermination of the Jews. Certainly, we wanted the Jews out of Germany, but we did not want them to be killed.
Even after the Night of the Broken Glass, almost no one suspected that the terrible prophecy Hitler made early in 1939 might have to be taken literally.
"Ich will heute wieder ein Prophet sein. Wenn es dem internationalen Finanzjudentum in und außerhalb Europas gelingen sollte, die Völker noch einmal in einen Weltkrieg zu stürzen, dann wird das Ergebnis nicht die Bolschewisierung der Erde und damit der Sieg des Judentums sein, sondern die Vernichtung der jüdischen Rasse in Europa."
The destruction of the Jews was only part of Hitler's demonic vision of an empire dominated by the German master race. Early in 1939, he opens the new Reichschancellery, built to rule a German empire which he boasts will last 1,000 years. At the time, few Germans could imagine exactly where the Führer's megalomania would take them. His vision, as it unfolded, was to be breathtaking and awful in its audacity. And nothing was more staggering than Hitler's belief that he could turn his obsessions into reality by sheer willpower. The failed artist in a Viennese Doss house now had the biggest study in the world. The ultimate target of Hitler's racist ambitions in the East was Soviet Russia, populated, he believed, by inferior races. But in a move of brilliant cunning, he astonished the world in the summer of 1939 by doing a deal with Stalin, whom he planned later to overthrow. The purpose of this cynical deal was to isolate Hitler's next victim, Poland. With Stalin on his side, Hitler was sure nobody else would interfere when he attacked the Poles. The 1st of September, 1939. The German attack on Poland begins the Second World War. To Hitler's surprise, Britain and France declare war on Germany. Their intervention, however, fails to help the Poles.
Hitler didn't want a general war. What he wanted, and I have no doubt about this, he wanted a war to destroy Poland. That he was prepared for. For a moment, he was disconcerted to find that he might be involved in war with Britain and France, because this had never been his plan. He had always regarded Britain as his natural ally. But in the end, he accepted, look, I have a Nazi-Soviet pact which guarantees that this will not develop into a general war. I should be able to knock Poland out in 3 weeks, which he more or less did. After that, the West isn't going to start up a war again.
Das Schicksal wird entscheidend errecht hat.
Many Germans were worried when they found themselves at war with Britain and France. There was none of the jubilation with which Hitler and many others had gone to war in 1914. Germans had got so used to the Führer's knack of getting what he wanted easily and without war that their faith was momentarily shaken.
Never did we think he would come to war. I never believed it could happen after all what had happened before, and England and France had so often given in with Czechoslovakia and all the kind of things that we never thought that that could happen. Never. That was one of the things where you thought, good God, what is he doing?
Am Morgen des 5. Juni treten deutsche Panzerdivisionen zum Angriff über die Somme an.
In May 1940, Hitler decides to knock out France and Britain before continuing his war of conquest in the East. In 6 weeks, a German blitzkrieg defeats France and forces Britain to evacuate its troops from the continent. The worries which most Germans had felt about the war in September 1939 dissolve. Paris is Hitler's.
Madeleine in Paris fühlt sich jeder wie im Paradies.
Jeder Mund lächelt freundlich dir zu. Jeder Blick sagt dir heimlich nur du.
Da sagt man nicht Monsieur, man sagt nur mon ami.
Man sagt nicht Mademoiselle, man sagt nur ma chérie.
Auf der Rue Madeleine in Paris fühlt sich jeder wie im Paradies.
When France fell to us in 1940, I don't think there were many Germans who didn't applaud it, including my usually imperturbable grandmother. That evening at the dinner table, she said, you gotta hand it to Adolf Hitler. He has finally paid him back for Alsace and Lorraine.
When Hitler came back to Berlin, well, it was a terrific, triumphant victory when he came. Everybody was smiling. We were frantic with joy, really, that at last France had gone. And we were quite certain that soon we would be in England.
The church bells rang all day, and the mood of elation.
My feelings towards Hitler were such as if he were some superhuman being between man and a god. He was sent by Providence, that's what he told the German people. All
now intends to use his hold over the German people to lead them into a war they do not want, a war of conquest and genocide in the East. For the moment, he deludes the cheering crowds into believing that after victory over Britain, Germany's triumph will be complete.
From now on, Germany was absolutely in a position to direct the course of the war. All we had to defeat now, we believed, was Britain. And Europe would be in our hands.
Oberstleutnant Gallant besteigt seine Maschine.
The German fighter ace Adolf Gallant also thinks the next priority is the Battle of Britain. But when he meets Hitler, he discovers that the Führer's priorities are different.
I talked to him that our good time would come and we could bomb London and the fighters could, English fighters couldn't take off. And they said, no. Stop this. I don't like this. I really don't like the fight against England. The English people are so similar people to the Germans and have the highest respect for the English building up an empire. So you must understand, I'm forced to fight this fight against England, but I don't like it.
I think that he himself had not got any great wish to engage on an invasion of Britain. Because all the time, by now, we know he was already beginning to get itchy and wanting to turn eastwards after defeating France. But Goering insisted that with the Luftwaffe, with the Air Force alone, he could knock Britain out. So he gave him his head to try. And that was a decisive defeat. But it was not really a setback to Hitler's main plan.
June 1941, Hitler travels to his Eastern Front headquarters, the Wolf's Lair, so called after his nickname, Wolf. The Führer is in high spirits as he arrives to direct the attack on Russia. The Second World War, he believes, will be decided on the Eastern Front. These are the forgotten, virtually indestructible ruins of the Wolf's Lair, where Hitler will spend most of the next few years. From here, he pursues the two great obsessions of his political career, the conquest of a great empire in the East and the destruction of the Jews. Russia will be defeated, he believes, well before winter sets in. We have only to kick in the door, Hitler boasts, and the whole rotten edifice will come crashing down. The German master race, he orders, must show no pity to the inferior Russians.
Artillerie und Panzer kämpfen die Straße wieder frei.
June the 22nd, 1941. Operation Barbarossa. Hitler's offensive takes the German people as well as the Russian army by surprise. But the anxiety many Germans feel is outweighed by their faith in the Führer.
He had been so right in everything, whatever he did, whether it was Poland, whether it was France, whether he walked through Belgium and so on, wherever he went, it went like lightning. No real fighting and so on. That we thought, well, perhaps he knows better, perhaps he has some armament which will do it.
Not merely did the German forces have no new armaments, they had no winter clothing either. When the winter campaign comes, Hitler's forces freeze. The offensive grinds to a halt. Germans are alarmed by the first publicly admitted setback of the war, but they quickly rally round. Hitler had given them the good times. It was their duty to stand by him in the bad.
Leid. So einen schönen Pelz, oh, ist das warm da drin.
Das ist selbstverständlich, für unsere Jungs draußen.
Ja, da ist ja sowas richtig.
Well, we all gave, and I remember my husband took his best pullover out and gave it to them, and I know my neighbor, who was always against, he said, don't give it, it won't reach the German soldiers in Russia, don't give it, keep it for yourself. But my husband said, we all have to give, everybody has to give.
Summer 1942 brings a new German offensive in the east, new German successes and a return of confidence. But although the ordinary soldiers have lost none of their faith in the Führer, Hitler is heading towards the abyss. He hasn't the resources to conquer Russia. With America now also at war against him, German defeat is only a matter of time. But Hitler still believes his willpower can sweep aside all obstacles.
We now get to the period when Hitler is constantly trapped in his own beliefs. He created a myth about himself, which he worked very hard at, that he was the man sent by Providence to save Germany and so on, and many people came to believe this in the days of his success and so on. Alas, he came from his point of view, not from ours, he came to believe it too.
Disaster strikes at Stalingrad in January 1943. Here, at the furthest point of Hitler's advance into Russia, a great German army is surrounded by the Russians. After savage fighting, 90,000 surrender. The myth of Hitler's invincibility is shattered. Privately, Hitler tells his staff, "What you are witnessing is a catastrophe of unheard of dimensions." Publicly, Nazi propaganda claims Stalingrad is a minor setback. After Stalingrad, Hitler was a changed man. The great public speaker of the 1930s became a semi-recluse, spending much of his time here at his Eastern Front headquarters, so-called Wolf's Lair, a great encampment of bunkers in the midst of an East Prussian forest. Visitors to the Wolf's Lair describe the atmosphere as a mixture of a monastery and a camp. The great mass of Germans never saw Hitler again. He avoided visits to the front, made no tours of bombed cities, gave only two major speeches for the remainder of the war. Yet such was the faith which the mass of Germans had acquired in the Führer over the past decade that it survived even disaster at Stalingrad. Faith in the Führer is further tested by massive British and American bombing raids on German cities. Over 300,000 civilians are killed. But though bombing strengthens the fear of defeat, morale does not crack.
We were sitting in the cellar day and night, mostly by night. People were sitting there in the cellar trembling, and we saw the walls shivering. Yes, the walls were trembling, and those nights we can never forget in our lives. I cannot forget ever. We asked ourselves, why are they doing this to Adolf Hitler? And we were told by everyone, because they hated the Führer, because the Führer wanted to create a better world. Maybe Churchill and Roosevelt thought they could demoralize the German people with bombing and make them surrender, but he reached the opposite of it.
When a ship is in a storm, you stand by your captain, for better or for worse.
Im weihevollen Gedenken grüßt der Führer verwundete deutsche Soldaten dieses Krieges.
As the tide turns in the Second World War, the nature of German loyalty to Hitler changes. The ardor goes, but the dependence remains. Quite simply, there was no one else for most Germans to turn to. The Allied demand for Germany's unconditional surrender, Hitler's insistence on final victory, and the traditional habit of obedience bind Führer and people in a community of fate which will be torn apart only by defeat and degradation. Auschwitz, Poland, the gateway to the most terrible place on earth, the most enduring monument to Hitler's anti-Semitic paranoia. His mission was, he said, to cleanse the German world of the Jewish poison. In this great human slaughterhouse alone, over 2 million Jews went to their deaths. Heinrich Himmler, head of the SS, was put in charge of a secret plan for genocide. Secret, because only a minority of fanatical Nazis shared Hitler's anti-Semitic obsession. Mass killings began in Eastern Europe at the beginning of the Russian campaign. The first SS executions, however, took place not in the camps, but in the countryside. German army officer Axel von den Buscher, then serving on the Eastern Front, unexpectedly saw the SS at work.
The regimental clerk, a sergeant, came in my office as ADC and said, "You've got to go out to the airport. Something is happening which you won't believe." So I went out half a mile through some woods. Marvelous, cool, dry autumn day, sun shining. There were trucks coming from the city, from the ghetto, which I found out later. A long queue of about 600-800 yards of naked people were queuing up and moving forward, went into this long queue and went into these mass graves prepared to lie like herrings in a tin and being shot in their neck. Responsibility in this kind of hierarchy is always with the Führer. There is absolutely no doubt that number one had to know and had given verbal mafia-like advice. Anybody who thinks differently just doesn't know how this kind of organization works. He would never write. He was sly enough not to give orders with top secret. Never. This would work through word of mouth, under all sorts of pseudo-humanitarian things, too many people, we can't feed them, and so on.
For the final solution, as it was euphemistically called, shooting was not sufficient. It killed only hundreds at a time. To kill millions, Hitler ordered a new technology of genocide to be secretly installed at death camps in Poland. Before they are sent to the gas chambers, the Jews are ordered to undress. Their clothes are collected by members of the so-called special commandos, Jews who are forced to work for the SS. The victims are told they are going to have showers and be deloused. Their hair, removed by the special commandos, is later sold to German factories.
גם כן, שאנשים התחילו לדבר איתנו. תגידו לנו את האמת. שאלתי, ואם תדע את האמת, יהיה לך יותר קל. ולא ידענו בעצמנו מה לעשות. לשקר בוודאי לא טוב. להגיד את האמת, אנשים נכנסו לפניקה.
The victims are pushed into the gas chambers, hundreds at a time. Cyclone B gas capsules are dropped through the ceiling.
אחר כך בא איש אס-אס, הוא פתח את הדלת מעבר השני. Liebe התמונה הזאת מזעזע, אם אני נזכר היום. קודם כל היה מזכיר את המשפחה בבית. איפה שהסתכלת, ראית דמיון של האבא, של האמא, של הילדים. כן, אם חשבנו על זה, שגם הם גם כמצורה כזאת נספו.
Gassed with the Jews are gypsies, homosexuals, Poles, Russian prisoners of war. All the gas chambers and crematoria are in occupied Poland to keep their functioning as secret as possible. But inevitably, rumors begin to circulate in Germany.
We suspected and we heard it by some other people telling about it, but like this, with a hand in front of their mouth, because you had to be always be careful that not a SR man or a Gestapo man was standing nearby and witness what you were talking. Otherwise, you would have been sent yourself to a concentration camp.
Though the great majority of Germans did not support genocide, years of anti-Semitic propaganda had left their mark.
The average German certainly did not care any longer what happened to the Jews. That is particularly true from 1943 on, when we came under the incessant Allied bombing. I remember having been told by a German officer on the Western Front that we were engaged in genocide. First of all, I didn't believe him. In fact, I was ready to turn him into the Gestapo. And secondly, it simply didn't penetrate. It didn't make any sense. It didn't make any economic sense. We needed these people as slave labor.
The only person known to have challenged Hitler about the final solution was Henrietta von Schirach. Because she had known Hitler since her childhood, she had no compunction about going to see him after accidentally witnessing Jews being rounded up in Amsterdam.
Und dann habe ich ihm das gesagt.
So I told him what I'd seen. His reply was, "You're sentimental." Then there was a terrible row. He stood up. I stood up. I said, "Herr Hitler, you ought not to be doing that." I thought I can allow myself to say such a thing because I've known him so long. I've hurt him deeply. What's more, in front of other men who were there. Then Hitler said, "Every day 10,000 of my best soldiers die on the battlefield, while the others carry on living in the camps. That means the biological balance in Europe is not right anymore."
How to react, how to stop, how to avoid, that was the question. This is Hitler. He's got to be eliminated. With all means, without any reserve.
The underground opposition to Hitler, to which Busche belonged, was motivated not just by moral outrage, but by the conviction that Hitler was leading Germany to inevitable defeat. They also knew that only assassination could snap the bonds of loyalty which still bound millions to Hitler. The ever-watchful Gestapo made opposition very difficult. The only plotters with access to the Führer were army officers. The officer who came closest to killing Hitler was Colonel Klaus von Stauffenberg. He had his opportunity at a briefing on the 20th of July, 1944. The briefing and the attempt on Hitler's life took place in a conference building which stood on this site. Stauffenberg put his briefcase containing the 2 pounds of explosive beneath the conference table, not far from Hitler. Shortly afterwards, claiming that he had to make a phone call, he left the building. A few minutes later, there was an enormous explosion. Though Hitler, in fact, survived, the bomb plot had almost succeeded. Four of those at the briefing were fatally injured. Hitler staggered from the building, convinced that Providence had delivered him. Behind the smile of the survivor lurked the rage of a man intent upon a terrible revenge. On Hitler's orders, the ringleaders of the bomb plot were strung up from these hooks by piano wire and their death agonies specially photographed for him.
I saw how Hitler grabbed at these photographs and how he looked at it with cruelty and gleefully. And I saw the face of one of my friends, of Peter Graf Jorg, who was executed among these people. And I was so terribly shocked about how Hitler acted in this moment that I had to leave the room.
When I heard that German officers had tried to kill Hitler, I was enraged. I fully concurred with the sentence that was imposed on them. Strangling, I thought, was too good for them. This was the time precisely when we were in a very precarious military situation, and the only man who could possibly stave off disaster was Adolf Hitler. That opinion was shared by many Germans, Germans who did not adore Hitler, did not belong to the party.
By winter, most Germans realized that defeat was only a matter of time. Hitler was visibly tiring. His earlier military inspiration had long deserted him. His strategy now was simply to hold out whatever the cost. For German civilians training for the final showdown, the motive for fighting now was less loyalty to Hitler than fear of being overrun by the massive Russian army rumbling towards Berlin. Early April 1945, and the Red Army reaches Berlin. Thousands of Germans are captured. His Grand Chancellery now severely damaged, Hitler was directing his depleted forces from the safety of a bunker 50 feet beneath the earth. This two-story complex, wrapped in concrete, was to be a last home for both him and Eva Braun, who had come to join him. Eva was given a bed sitter next to Hitler's little suite. The rooms were sparsely furnished. The air was stuffy, despite a ventilation system whose shrill, monotonous whine penetrated everywhere. Hitler rarely left this claustrophobic fantasy world. Although his contact with reality was slipping, he retained the ability to delude and inspire his bunker staff.
It was about March or April when the situation in Berlin was rather hopeless. He was all of a sudden interested to see the model of Linz. Linz was his home city, and he had special plans to make it the most beautiful town of Austria. And he took a few of his people and the secretaries to accompany him. And we went over there, and he stood in front of this model, and he was just excited. He was so happy, and he, Speer had to explain to him every detail of the new gallery and the beautiful places he planned. And I stood there and watched him, and I thought, maybe it's not all hope lost if he can plan for the future in that way. But I think it was only an escape for him in his daydream of architecture.
Outside the bunker, most Germans by now are resigned to defeat, longing for an end to the war. Only among the Hitler youth does the Führer still have followers who have not despaired of victory. For them, the fatal attraction holds firm to the end. This last film of Hitler shows him reviewing war heroes from his youth movement. Among those he pats feebly on the cheek is Wilhelm Hübner.
I told Hitler that I was a messenger boy for the army.
And perhaps that struck a chord with him, because he'd been a regimental messenger during the First World War. Anyway, he then patted my cheek and said, "Well done, my boy."
Didn't you realize at the time that the war was lost?
Nein, überhaupt nicht.
No, not at all. We boys still thought, and we'd heard rumors, that the Führer somehow had a secret weapon in reserve.
Weil einige Sachen waren ja schon da.
In fact, there were no secret weapons. On the day the Russians started smashing their way into Berlin, Hitler flew into a rage. After shrieking at his officers that they had betrayed him, he admitted for the first time that all was lost. He then stepped into the passage where Eva and the secretaries were waiting.
All of a sudden, the door was open, Hitler came out. He said with a very, very grave face, "Everything is lost. Pack your things and go. You have to leave in within an hour. The last plane will bring you out of Berlin." He didn't look at us, actually. Then, after a moment of silence, Eva Braun stepped forward, went to him, took his hand and said, "But you know I stay with you. I wouldn't go." And he smiled. He tried to smile and he kissed her on the lips. And somehow, in this moment, it was just following Eva Braun, we all said we are staying too. And then he was sort of relieved, I would say. And he said, "I wish my generals would be as brave as you are."
The generals now left. Only a few officers stayed with Hitler's little court.
The atmosphere was very gloomy in the bunker, and the other people, they talked about how to commit suicide. That was the main topic about their talks, and whether they should take poison themselves, or whether they should shoot with a pistol.
It was just like talking about recipes for cooking. We talked about recipes for making suicide, and it just was to overcome the fear, actually. We tried to be calm, but actually it was not really. It was a sort of trance. And in one of these discussions, I asked Hitler why he didn't fight in the battle, as a commander should in the war. And he said, "No, it's impossible. I'm much too weak to fight. And I would never risk to get captured alive." Because he knew what happened to Mussolini. He saw the pictures. And he was very, very frightened to have the same fate if he would be captured.
On the 28th of April, Hitler's fellow dictator Mussolini and his mistress had been shot by Italian partisans, their bodies mutilated and strung up in a Milan square. Hitler was incapable of leading his troops in the way he had led his stormtroopers through the streets of Munich 20 years earlier. He was ill and prematurely aged.
Hitler war hauptsächlich psychosomatisch krank.
Hitler suffered primarily from psychosomatic illnesses, mainly stomach cramps. These had first occurred back in the 20s and had continued at varying intervals right up to the time I saw him. In addition, he suffered from a shaking left arm and, to a lesser extent, a quivering left leg, though this only became apparent after the assassination attempt in July
44. Hitler war mit Sicherheit nicht verrückt.
When I saw Hitler, none of his remarks during my treatment of him suggested madness. There was nothing extraordinary about his behavior. Of course, one must differentiate between someone who is mad and someone who's abnormal. He was definitely not mad, in my opinion.
Verrückt war er mit Sicherheit nicht, nach meiner Ansicht.
the Soviet army hacked its way towards the center of Berlin. His mystical union with the German people now almost at an end, Hitler decided to marry his long-suffering mistress, Eva Braun. On April the 29th, a municipal official was hastily pulled out of the front line and hurried to the map room. After the bridal couple had confirmed they were of true Aryan descent, the ceremony was concluded with Goebbels and Bormann as the witnesses. Hitler signed the wedding certificate, but when it came to Eva's turn, she began to write her surname as Braun, before crossing out the letter B and writing Eva Hitler. Arm in arm, Adolf Hitler led his bride to the study for the wedding reception. Eva put on the one record that could be found in the bunker. It was called Red Roses. Hitler joked, and the guests drank Tokai. There was talk of happier times.
I think Hitler married Eva Braun as a gesture of gratitude for her love, for her loyalty, for her fidelity. And I think he wanted to compensate for her, as she was not allowed to live with him, that she was at least allowed to die with him and be honored, therefore, to get the figure of history as his wife.
This is the last photograph of Hitler alive, with the Russians only a few hundred yards away. Shortly afterwards, he went down into the bunker for the last time.
And there he stood, very quiet, very tired, very pale, looking into nothing. And he came towards me, shook hand, and murmured something. And I was so nervous that I didn't understand what he said. And then he turned, and I felt somehow like frozen, because I knew now that this is a decisive moment where he would go into his room and shoot himself. But then Eva Braun was still there, and she came towards me, embraced me, and said, "Try to go home, try to get out of here. And if you are successful, if you come to Bavaria back, give my greeting, my regards to everybody." And she was very sad, and I think she tried to be very brave in this moment.
Less than 2 days after the wedding, on April the 30th, Hitler and his bride retired to his study. They sat on the couch. Opposite them was a portrait of Hitler's mother. On an iron clothes rack hung a dog leash. Hitler's dog had been sacrificed, testing the poison. Eva now took a cyanide capsule and popped it into her mouth. She died instantly. Then Hitler picked up his gun, put it to his right temple, and fired.
That was the shot Hitler ended his life with. And I was sitting there, and all of a sudden I had a feeling of hate. I felt so lonely, I felt so lost. And I didn't know what to do, actually.
Acting in accordance with Hitler's instructions, members of his staff wrapped both the bodies in blankets and carried them up to the surface. During a pause in the Russian shelling, they doused the bodies with what petrol they had managed to collect and set them alight. Later, they buried the incompletely burnt corpses in shallow graves. The charred remains were discovered by the Russians when they overran the bunker. On May the 7th, a week after Hitler's suicide, Germany surrenders. The Führer died without pity for the people who had followed him so loyally. He had warned them 2 years before that if Germany were defeated, they would be to blame.
Wenn mein eigenes Volk an einer solchen Prüfung zerbrechen würde, könnte ich darüber dann keine Träne weinen. Es hätte nichts anderes verdient. Es würde sein eigenes Schicksal sein. dass es sich selbst zuzuschreiben hat.
Germans are now brought face to face with the reality of genocide. Lampshades made from human skin. Human organs extracted in sadistic medical experiments. Hitler's Germany had ended not as he had promised in national renewal, but in national degradation. Mounds of human bodies, starved and tortured to satisfy the Führer's racist obsession. The fatal attraction had made possible the final solution. The remains of the bunker where Hitler committed suicide are close to this mound in the death strip along the Berlin Wall. Ironically, the division of Germany is one of the legacies of Hitler's defeat.
The thousand-year Reich promised by Adolf Hitler lasted only 12 years. That horrific episode in German history was the product not of some incurable strain of German megalomania, but of the fatal attraction for the German people in the midst of a terrible crisis of Hitler's messianic vision of a great national revival. With total defeat in the Second World War, the suicide of the Führer and the appalling revelations of the death camps, the spell was broken.
I can't change the past, and I can't deny that I was fascinated by Hitler's personality, that I liked him as a friendly and a polite and a very fatherly chief. And it was the most interesting time of my life. But when I came out of the bunker and home from prison, and I realized what really had happened in the world, what damage, what misery he had brought to millions of people, I was very much shocked and ashamed. And when I experienced the first time in my life what democracy can be, what freedom means, I can only wish that there would never ever again any other Hitler in the world.